This recording was rediscovered by Sheikh Ahmed Didat in 2004 while he was bedridden, paralyzed and unable to talk. He communicated his desire for everyone to watch this recording, which he called Didat a Fundamentalist. He used his communication board to express his desire to release this recording. It was recorded during March 1996, shortly before Sheikh Didat became seriously ill. A Christian television journalist came to interview Sheikh Didat about Islamic fundamentalism and other issues around it. As you will see, the journalist was well aware and well armed of the works of Sheikh Didat. Whether this interview was ever produced and aired on television by the journalist is unknown. This version was recorded by the secret cameras in Sheikh Didat's office. It is released in the hope that it will benefit Muslims about how to respond to questions about Islamic fundamentalism, as well as enlighten non-Muslims more about this very current topic, especially after 9/11 and the London bombings.
What is, the Western world and the Christian world knows Islamic fundamentalism, and the picture it paints to me and to a lot of people, a lot of Christians, is violence, because that's the picture we see. We see bombs going off in Israel, and that's jihad or Hamas. What is Islamic fundamentalism?
You know, this is a very strange thing. This word fundamentalist and fundamentalism does not exist in the vocabulary of Islam. In Arabic, in Urdu, in none of our native languages this word is to be found. This word fundamental and fundamentalism is an invention of the Americans. They invented this word to describe those Bible thumpers, those who say that every word and letter of the Bible was revealed by God, every comma, full stop and colon was revealed by God, they call them fundamentalists. Who called them fundamentalists? Not the Muslims. You Christians call them fundamentalists. And by extension, anyone who goes to extremes in religion, you start labeling them. So now if anybody, a Muslim, goes, does something extreme, immediately you call him, label him a fundamentalist. Forgetting that in Christendom you had similar type of people. Reverend Jim Jones in Jonestown, Guyana. He committed suicide with 911 of his followers en masse. He was a Christian fundamentalist. But you don't call him so. That David Koresh, that Wacko, you remember Wacko? That gang was a fundamentalist. You don't call them fundamentalists. These pro-lifers in America were bombing hospitals where they do abortion and killing people. They are fundamentalists, but you don't call them fundamentalists. I want to know why. A fellow by the name of Ferguson, an Afro-American, on the New York Express at 5:33, he went and shot down people. That guy was a fundamentalist. But you don't call him a fundamentalist. This Jew who went and slaughtered the Muslims at prayer in a mosque, that American who had settled down in the guy was a fundamentalist. You don't call him a fundamentalist. The guy who shot Rabin is a fundamentalist, but you don't call him fundamentalist. How is it that you only seem to be applying this on Muslims? You got double standards. You have fundamentalists, those guys in Japan, that gas, gassing people, if you remember in Tokyo or something, so many people died. Those guys are fundamentalists. But you don't call them fundamentalists. It's only a Muslim becomes a fundamentalist. I want to know why. Yes, you have extremes among Christians and Hindus and Jews and Shintos, Japanese. You also have extremists among the Muslims. But now this label is uncalled for.
Would you consider yourself an extremist if you're going to put that label on it?
I would say I accept the fundamentals of my faith. I believe in them and I live by them. For example, Islam forbids me the touching of alcohol. So I say, right, we won't touch it. Say, no eating of the flesh of swine. Says, I won't touch it. No eating of blood. I says, I won't touch it. It says, no gambling. I says, no gambling. No promiscuousness. No dancing with other people's wives and daughters. I says, I won't do that. Pray 5 times a day. I says, I will try and do that. Fast for 1 whole month in the month of Ramadan, from before sunrise to sunset. No eating, no drinking, no sniffing, no smoking. I said, I will do that. So if that makes me a fundamentalist, I am a fundamentalist, and I want every Muslim and every Christian and every Jew to follow the religion that way. That if your religion tells you that, Jesus said, you must not look upon a woman to lust after her. Do you live by that? No, you don't. I said, I would like to see you do that. That you have no more beauty contest, no more long leg contest, no more beach bump contest, which is going on. And you are good Christians. You go to church regularly. So I said, no, I want you to be a fundamentalist in that respect. In the teachings of Christ, follow it to the letter. Teaching of the Bible, follow it to the letter. The Muslim, so follow the Quran to the letter. In spirit and in form. So now, if that is called fundamentalism, then I think all good religious people of every church and denomination will be a fundamentalist.
Mm-hmm.
And you have an exceptional type of people in America. I read a book by Billy Graham, How to be Born Again. And in that he says there are 75 million born-again Christians in America. They are all fundamentalists. Accepted. As such, I am a fundamentalist. But I don't believe in throwing stones or grenades at people if they don't agree with me. I'm prepared to talk to them, reason with you.
Hmm.
I said, now, my sister, you see, this is where, you know, you have misunderstood this. And you argue and debate to me, trying to put me right. I said, that's all valid.
Hmm.
That I'm prepared to do, to talk to people, to Hindus, to Christians, to Jews, to the atheists, the agnostic. I want to talk to them all, trying to bring them to God, God's ways. And if you call me fundamentalist, I'll be proud. That makes me a fundamentalist. But I don't believe in killing.
I'd like to, you say that you don't believe in throwing stones or bombs, yet the groups that the West has called fundamentalist Islamic groups, as well as the Jewish fundamentalist groups, are killing each other in Palestine and Israel. They are bombing people, they are killing innocent people.
True.
And on page 72 of your book, you say, The gun is not the answer. Put down your sword, for all they that take up the sword will perish by the sword. And yet, further on in your book, you're saying 300 years of slavery and hammering has turned the Afro-American Muslims into one of the most militant Muslim communities in the world. Arm him. Help him to Islamize America before Armageddon overtakes America.
Right.
So it appears to me that in the same book you are saying we should not live by the sword, but then we must arm ourselves.
No, arm yourself with knowledge. You see, you say, arm him with what? With grenades, with guns? I says, no.
With the same, you're saying the militancy.
The intellect. Once you give that person something to talk about, like the born-again Christian, he's coming in knocking at our doors. He's armed with certain type of specialized knowledge. Christ died for your sins. Jesus said, I and my Father are one. Jesus said, he that has seen me has seen the Father. So he is armed with that, and with that he is coming along to get customers, converts, people. So knowledge, arm yourself with knowledge that you can talk. Otherwise 25 million Afro-Americans, Suppose they all become Muslims. 250 million of others. What can they do? What can they do with any type of force? So no, but there is a force of the intellect. Talk, man, talk. Change the people. Make them to see, to think like you, to see things like you. And they are yours. So when I say Amish, you know, the whole thing is, you know what I'm talking about. I don't tell you the Arabs, so go and, you know, supply them with guns or grenades. I said, help them with the Quran. Help them with the type of books that I'm writing. In other words, you arm the people to do the job. You arm them with knowledge, not with guns and grenades.
But now, what's happening in Palestine, etc.? Would you, do you support that violence that groups like Hamas are committing, as well as...
No, I support no violence from either side. I have been telling, now, if you read the book, this book of mine, you see that I'm suggesting, we must have a dialogue with the Jew. Talk to him, man, talk to him. Because I have been talking to Jews, and I've been talking to Christians. And when I'm talking to them, I can see that they are a very reasonable people. Ah, you have extremists among them. But I can see when I'm talking to them, I work for Jews. And as such, I came into close contact with them. They came to my home. We have been chatting at work, we have been chatting, arguing and debating. Then I have lectured to Jewish students at the University of Cape Town, University of Natal, Witwatersrand University. I've been talking to Jewish students. And I find them fantastic audiences, wonderful audiences. Oh, they put up a fight. That's it. That is the nature of the student, you see. University student, you know, he is full of life and energy. He wants to show what he knows. But at the end of it, I can see they are a very reasonable people. So I said, learn to talk. And I tell you now, I show you what to talk about. And I'm not the only guy who just tells you, you know, you must do this and do that. I said, no, I show you how to talk, what to talk. Listen to me. Says I have some over 80 different videotapes on religious topics, right? Including Israel set up for destruction, or Arabs and Israel, conflict or conciliation. Now, all these things are there. This is the way of showing people how you can arm yourself with knowledge that you can share and make the people to think like you. See your point of view.
Yeah. Your propagation center is trying to, let's say, convert Christians to Islam with adverts that you place in the newspaper, etc. Quotes such as, leave your sectarian attitude and follow Islam. I've also been quoted by somebody that Christianity is considered as a standard 8 of religion, whereas Islam is considered matric. Is your intention to get people to follow Islam, even if it's by coercion or force,
no,
considering that the Quran says there shall be no compulsion in religion?
I don't quote you. So the Quran says, like Rafiddin, there is no compulsion in religion. By force, somebody makes you to say some formula. For example, you have come into my office, and me and my gang, you know, we pull out a gun. I said, come on, say the Shahada, the Muslim form of conversion, to articulate that formula. Otherwise, we blast you. I said, what's that, uncle? I said, say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, which means that there is no other object of worship but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger. So you bleed that. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. What is it worth? It's rubbish. That's rubbish. It must come voluntarily from you. He says, uncle, I'd like to be one of you. He says, my child, you have to go through a certain process. You know, I have to give you all your do's and don'ts, you know, your obligations. And you agree with all that, then you can become a Muslim. You are welcome. Whether you are a white Caucasian or an African or a Bushman or a Hottentot, whatever you are, if you agree to the way of life that we want you to lead, you are a Muslim. Your concept of God, the way we have, you have, you are a Muslim. So we want to make the whole world to think like us. Islam is a missionary religion as much as Christianity is. Christianity is a missionary religion. It wants to convert the whole world to its way of thinking, to its way of salvation. Islam also wants the whole world to accept Islam. as a solution to all of mankind's problems. So it is my duty and every Muslim's duty to talk to people. And in that, I am prepared to talk to the Hindu, to the Christian, to the Jew, because that's the foremost duty of every Muslim is that, to share his faith with other people.
But Christians and Jews are said by Islam to be people of the book.
Right.
And their religions respected,
right,
and allowed to continue in peace.
Right, right.
How can you then be determined to make South Africa an Islamic country? Surely that's then not respecting and leaving the other religions to practice in peace.
No. This is voluntarily done. Like today now, 80% of the Africans are Christians. How do you do it? With a gun? No, by missionary work. So if by missionary work, if I start talking to you and you say, no, uncle, I see your point of view. You know, I said, I'm trying to tell you. I said, look, Islam is the culmination of the teachings of Moses and Jesus. You are, as you gave that expression, I said, now, the Jew, I said, he is in a standard 6 stage. As standard 6 education, we had a PSC, I passed PSC, primary certificate examination, standard 6, that was standard 6. Then we had JC, that's standard 8. Then we had matric, that's standard 10. So I said, figuratively, I said, you see, the Jew is in the standard 6 stage. The Christians have come up standard 8 stage. I said, no, that's not the end of education. Jesus Christ, he said, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. How be it? When he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak from himself, but what things so shall he hear, that shall he speak. And he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. He shall glorify me. We Muslims, we say that Spirit of truth is Muhammad. And he's guided mankind into all truth. Means he's given solutions to all your problems. All your problems. Come to Islam. He shows you how to solve the problems. Not only just by talking, problem of race, racism. It's still there. Still there. You just can't wash it off by putting certain clauses in the constitution. You can't eliminate racism from your hearts. Now Islam has a system. The only religion on the face of the earth which prohibits the touching of alcohol, not one sip, not one tot, is Islam. There's no other religion on earth which says don't touch that abominable stuff, is Islam. Is it a good thing or a bad thing? If all the people of South Africa, Indians, Africans, coloreds and whites, if they stop drinking, no more bottle stores, no more wineries and no more breweries in the country, would it be a better country or not? So I reasoned with you and said, no, it will be a better country, but you know, how can we? Our industries depend upon this and that and that. I said, no, it's your vested interest. You people who are running the country, you have all your shares in the Stellenbosch winery and this Lion brewery. So in other words, you want to perpetuate that exploitation of the nation. But then I said, if you think like the Muslim, no Muslim owns a bottle store. Did you know that? It's an easy money.
What about the choice of the people who are buying alcohol to buy it?
You see, as a Muslim, I can't sell bottle. I can't sell alcohol. Because now, as a Muslim, you come to buy a bottle of champagne or vodka. Now, I have to tell you, says, you know, madam, this is very dangerous. You know, this is not a good thing. Do you think I will be able to do business? Selling all my wines and all that. I tell you, every customer that comes along, I says, you know, madam, you know what this thing does. You read the book of Genesis, chapter 19. Lot, what he did with his daughters, night after night. He committed incest with his daughters because he was drunk. Do you know that? It's a very bad thing. You know, Noah, he drank too much and he was lying naked, made a fool of himself. A man who walked before God, who walked with God. That guy behaving like, what? So I said, no, it's not a good thing. And we hear about cases, you know, rape and incest and all. Alcohol. Say it is an evil, an abomination. And the only religion which condemns it in the strongest of terms is Islam. And Islam has created the biggest society of teetotalers in the world. We are almost 1 billion Muslims in the world, and almost as the people as a whole, we don't touch that stuff. Don't you think we should share this with the rest of mankind? what are we trying to do? We are not forcing you that if you went to the bottle store, we don't say go and bomb the bottle stores or kill the people who go and buy alcohol. But we want to talk to you. Say it is not a good thing, my child. And if you can agree with me, we have one more to think like me. And one day, we say, inshallah, God willing, the whole of mankind will be able to establish the kingdom of God on earth as Jesus Christ prayed for. That kingdom of God means you lead your life according to God's will and plan. Whatever He wants you to do, you do. That is the kingdom of God we want to establish here on this earth. But not with the gun, not with the grenade. With sweet language. If it can be done, we try to do that.
You've said before, and your center said before, that Islam is the only answer to South Africa's problems. What solutions do you have? What practical solutions does Islam offer? And what would that mean? What would those solutions mean to other religions already existing here?
No, this is a vulnerable thing. Once you accept, for example, our biggest problem in South Africa has been for the past 300 years and now is racism. Everybody talks about the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Everybody. The Jew will say, there's one our Father in heaven, God Almighty, and we are all His children. The Christian says the same thing. Father in heaven, and we are His children. The Muslim will say, ditto. Father in heaven, and we are His children. We must live in peace and harmony as real brothers and sisters. So everybody talks that. But how do you implement that? The system was for 300 years that you kept all the races separate. You had the Dutch Reformed Church. For the whites, separate. For the colored, separate. For the African, separate. For the Indian, separate. In the Roman Catholic Church, they didn't have that type of different churches. But here's the cathedral here, and I used to live here in this road called Cathedral Road. And every year there was a Corpus Christi procession passing my door. Every once a year, Corpus Christi, body of Christ. They used to march, go to the Albert Park and offer praise and all that, and they used to come back. Invariably, every year I'm watching the white, men, women and children in the front. Next comes the colored, men, women and children. Then comes the Indian, men, women and children. Then comes the African, men, women and children. Invariable setup. Who told them that? That the African knew his place, and the colored knew his place, and the Indian knew his place. No. You programmed him that way, that this is where you belong. So though you talk about the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man, it wasn't there. In the house of Islam, if you ever visit a Muslim at prayer, and it's worth visiting, it's worth recording for your audiences, you watch that everybody stands shoulder to shoulder. The hall is packed. But you find nobody says, look, I stand near the window, it's a hot day. No. The system. Fill the rows. Side by side, shoulder to shoulder.
Do the women stand shoulder to shoulder with the men?
No. There is what is called a segregation of the sexes. Men and women are not allowed to freely intermingle. So in the absence of a separate facility, they pray at home. But in this mosque there is a separate facility, upstairs. They are in the mosque and yet out of the mosque. What Islam forbids is this free intermingling. But women to women, you are a Bantu woman, you are a Muslim lady, you are white, and a Bantu woman is standing next to you, a Chinese woman is standing next to you, and you offer your prayers, no gaps left between one devotee and another. Same thing to the men. So five times a day, the people are made to come together. They're using the same taps for ablution. They're using the same towels for wiping their faces. And it doesn't occur in the minds of these people that an African had just used that tap, or the African has just wiped his face. It doesn't occur to him. The man who's calling the people of prayer is almost invariably in every mosque in South Africa an African. What for? He has a tone, his bass voice, compared to the Indian, shrill voice. You know, we are shouting the same words, but our voice sounds sharp and shrill. That guy is so mellow. So we say, no, we like that, his voice. So almost every mosque in the center of the town is an African. He is the guy behind the imam to call the people, come on, fill the rows. So, in other words now, it doesn't occur to us that the guy is an African. Because that's our training. You know, he is like Bilal. Bilal was the companion of the Prophet. He was an Abyssinian, a Negro from Abyssinia. He was a freed slave. And he occupied such a high position in the house of Islam. He's like one of your 12 disciples of Jesus. Bilal was one of the 12 like around Muhammad. So, an Abyssinian Negro. So, to us, it's a programming. 5 times a day, we meet, and we end our prayer with the formula by saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So, peace and blessings of God to everybody to the right of me. And Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And peace and blessings of God to everybody to the left of me. When I did that, I found a white man there. When I did this, I found an African here. Next time, I found a Chinese here. I found a... Goodness, 5 times a day, he's my brother. He's my brother. There's a system. Not just talking, there's a system. Which, then once in a lifetime, the guy goes on a pilgrimage. There he finds Muslims he can't imagine. Chinese Muslims. Chinese Muslims. Muslims from Ethiopia, black as black. Muslims from Turkey, with blonde hair and blue eyes like you. The brotherhood said, this is my brother, this is my brother. We get together. So it is a system. Then the only religion which says don't touch alcohol. The only religion says no gambling. The only religion says no promiscuousness. Now once you accept these principles, you get together, you have common ideals, then you'll be able to say, you know, close down your bottles, your wineries and your breweries, close, and your pockeries, you know, close them down, and it can happen. If the people vote so, if the people is what they want, we want to reach that stage when the people say, no alcohol, no gambling, no dancing, no pigs in the country. We don't want to do it with guns and grenades, but we want to win over your willful acceptance of our principles.
Mr. Didat, you said that the Christian religion and the Jewish religion and Islam believes of one brotherhood, believes in
We all claim.
Yeah. But by saying that, you are saying to me, only Islam people don't sin. Only Islamic people don't break those vows.
No. I don't mean that. But you see, this is the only religion which now it talks and practices it. We don't say we are angels. We also have our black sheep, like any other community. You know, whether they are Christians, Hindus or Jews, we all have our black sheep. We Muslims are not exempt from that. But as a people as a whole, I said 1 billion people as a whole, they don't touch alcohol. As a whole, we in South Africa, I'm boasting and nobody has contradicted me yet. I said we Muslims in South Africa, we have the lowest alcoholic consumption in the country. We have the lowest gambling rate in the country. We have the lowest divorce rate in the country. We have the lowest suicide rate in the country. And we have the highest charity rate in the country. And nobody questions me. I said, come on, look around and you see how we Muslims live among the Indians. I'm an Indian Muslim, there are Indian Hindus. You ask an old Indian Hindu that if he wanted £5, the good old days, and there's a Muslim shopkeeper and there's a Hindu shopkeeper, who will you go to? He said, I'll go to the Muslim fellow. So what for? We are Hindus. You tell your grandfather, we were Hindus, daddy. He said, no, that guy can't say no. No, no, it's a training. You know, you're programming, you're brainwashing. We have been brainwashed that way. It makes it difficult for us to say no. It's not a part of your training. To give charity is good. But our is an injunction that 2.5% of all your wealth, whatever you have for the year, give 2.5% of it, 1/40. And every year, if you got 1 million, every year out of that 1 million, 2.5% goes out. So in 40 years' time, if you didn't do anything else, all your money is gone. So, makes you to do some work. He said, no, I want money not to finish. So what? Come on. Invest it. And no interest. No building societies. No banking in a way you get interest to say, now I can sit back and earn a living. No, no, no. You put your money to work. You work and you put your money to work. Now, this is the system which creates a type of society which we say, establish the kingdom of God on earth, which Jesus Christ wanted us to establish.
But is that not a religion that's a dictatorship to people?
This is the teaching of Christ. This is the teaching of the Bible. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Is that not a dictatorship? God says, I shall have no graven images before me, not even the likeness of the things on earth, or in the heavens above, or in the waters beneath the sea, for my name is jealous and I'm a jealous God. Is that not dictatorship? He said, the flesh of the swine thou shalt not eat, its carcass thou shalt not touch. Do you know that? That's in your Bible. Huh? And Jesus Christ said, you know, the guy who offends one of these little ones, he said, it is better for him that a millstone be tied around his neck and thrown in the sea. Is that not all dictatorship? No, no. This is the law of God. We want you to lead your life according to that. This is God's law. And if you want peace, we say there is no other way but to submit to his law for everybody's benefit. It doesn't say that you Muslims, you must not drink, but you sell it to the Christian. Let him become a drunkard. Let him ruin his life. No, no. Islam doesn't say that. He says, not only that I can't drink, I'm not supposed to drink, but I'm not supposed to plant vine, grape trees. The Holy Prophet Muhammad said, cursed is he who grows grapes for brewing. Cursed is he who crushes it. Cursed is he who bottles it. Cursed is he who sells it, and cursed is he who drinks it. So the Muslim has got nothing to do with this type of industry. But planting grapes or any other fruit in the house of Islam is an act of charity. It's an act of virtue. If you plant it for eating, it's a blessing. If you plant it for selling, it's a blessing. But if you plant with the idea, what am I going to do with all these grapes? In Stellenbosch, if you're living, you inherited 50 acres or 50 hectares of land. What are you going to do with all those grapes? He said, no, I'll send it to the winery. I send it to the brewery. You are an accursed person. But he said, no, I'm going to sell it 6 pence a pound, not 5 cents a pound. Let the people have it, enjoy it. It's an act of virtue. So this is how Islam wants to change your outlook. Pigs is a very easy thing to rear. Money, 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 pigs. Alcohol, money, money, money. Tattoo sales, gambling, money, money, money. But the Muslim, his hands are clean, relatively. I can't find a Muslim who's doing that. No bottle stores. No wineries, no shares in the wineries or breweries, no, and no share in the gambling dens. That is the Muslim. We are not angels. We also have our devils, but as a people as a whole, Jesus said, by the fruits ye shall know them. Test them by the fruits. The Muslim. Compare them with any other community. As a people as a whole. We are not talking about individuals. What about that Mr. Muhammad there and that Mr. Muhammad there? I said, no, I have to apologize for that Muhammad and this Muhammad and that Muhammad. But I said, no, as a people, as a whole, you judge this type of people. We are the most law-abiding citizens for the past 300 years in this country. That's our apartheid government. The testimony. The most law-abiding people in South Africa were the Muslims.
Both Muslim and Christian have told me when I mentioned you and your propagation center that you are not the spokesperson of Islam in this country at all. What would your comment be on that?
Now, I thought if I knew this before, you came went around meeting them, I would have told you, if they tell you that, ask them, have you got a spokesman at all? Have you got a spokesman at all? That is, no, not the that, but so-and-so, so-and-so. And the guy will tell you, no. So look, you have number one. To start with, there is no such thing as a spokesman for Islam. Every Muslim is supposed to be a spokesperson for Islam. Then I said, you see, in the case of Jesus, was he a spokesman for Jewry? Was he? No. His people, every time he opened his mouth, they picked up stones to stone him. What kind of a spokesman is that? That's history. Your Bible is full of it. Every time he opened his mouth, they picked up stones again to stone him, and again, picked up stone again to stone him. He was no spokesman for Jewry, was he? No, he wasn't. Paul was persecuted. Peter was persecuted. The Holy Prophet Muhammad, when he declared his mission, was he a spokesman for his people? No. The whole nation went against him. His whole nation. For 13 years he suffered at their hands. 2 migrations. To Abyssinia, the Muslims had to flee twice to Abyssinia, and the Holy Prophet Muhammad after 13 years had to also flee for his life. So, in other words, he was no spokesman for the Arabs. Jesus was not a spokesman for Jewry, and I can't claim to be a spokesman for the community of Muslims. No. But as a Muslim, it is every Muslim's duty, according to his capacity, according to your knowledge, you share. There are people who like it, people who don't like it. And there are different reasons for people not loving a person. There are different reasons. Maybe somebody don't like your beard, somebody don't like the tone of your voice, you know, you'll be too loud and you're like... These are 100 different reasons a man finds if you don't want to like a bad person. If you want to dislike a person, there are 100 different reasons. You can hate Jesus, and you can hate Muhammad, and you can hate Ahmadinejad.
Because these people have said they are spokespeople, they are chairmen of Islamic Foundation groups that are, that they would prefer of a spokespeople of Islam.
Who is talking? The only person in South Africa who's talking is me. There's not a single Muslim in the history of South African Muslims have ever been to the City Hall of Durban, Johannesburg, Cape Town, Maritzburg to go and deliver the message of Islam. There hasn't been. In the history of South Africa, it hasn't happened. Right? And that happens to be the only guy doing the job. So, there are people who might resent it. They say, look man, this guy is not a learned fellow, and I'm not. According to your people's academic education, I am not an educated fellow. I was set up for this. You know, when I tell people that, you know, I'm a standard 6 Johnny, the PSC, I was like, primary certificate, I'm a standard 6 Johnny, and I am recognized in the whole Muslim world as an authority on comparative religion. So, this puppy is around. If they say, look, I don't recognize, it doesn't matter. What does the world say? My society happens to be the most successful of any religious organization of this nature in the world. The proof of the pie is in the eating. By the fruits you shall know them. The fruits. Your societies and bodies, what are the fruits? My boys and society, what are the fruits? So this is it. I'm invited to Australia. At the end of the month, I'm going to Australia on a lecture tour. There's an invitation from America, from England, from the Arab countries. They want me, they're hungry for me. But Jesus said a prophet is not without honor, except in his own country. That was his position. So if my position becomes similar, it doesn't really worry me. This was Jesus, the Prince of Peace. People, you know, he said in his own Galilee, he said, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own people, his own family.
If South Africa, let's say years down the road, was to become an Islamic country, what would the practical implications be to our society? Regarding religion, and secondly regarding how would the laws of this country change?
As with regards to religion, there's freedom of religion. Islam allows freedom of religion. You see, the Muslims ruled Spain for 800 years. We ruled Spain, a European nation, for 800 years. But after 800 years of Muslim rule, the Muslims were kicked out to a man. There was not one person left in that country to give the azan, the Muslim call to prayer, after 800 years of Muslim rule. So if there was any type of coercion, I can't imagine for 800 years the Spanish people could have survived as Christians. We Muslims ruled India for 1,000 years. And after 1,000 years of Muslim rule, eventually when partition takes place, the Muslim gets one quarter, the Hindu gets three quarter. If we use any type of force, these Hindus wouldn't have been left there. So Islam gives you freedom of religion. If people as a whole, if you think alike, the majority of the people feel that, you know, you have a referendum or that you have, like the political party ANC, if it was voted into power with some 80% or 90%, they wouldn't have needed anybody's assistance in the voting to change the constitution. So they say, you know, so 80% of the people, if they were all ANC, or if the Inkatha becomes 80% in the government, they don't need any help from anybody else to change the constitution. So, similarly, now, if we reach such a stage that the bulk of the people are Muslims and they vote the Muslim party into power and they say, right, no alcohol in the country. All the wineries and the breweries must close down. All the bottle stores must close down. What objection has any reasonable person to have against that? If 80% of your people, 75% of your people says no alcohol, no gambling, no racing, what is wrong with that? If this is what the people want, give it to them. If they want abortion, give it to them. If they say no abortion, give it to them. That's what you say, that's your philosophy. So then what have you to grumble over? So this is, we want to reach a stage where the masses of the people, they think like me. That's what I want to talk to people. I want you to think like me. I want everybody to think like me. So once you think like me, one day, maybe we can establish that type of kingdom of God on earth, which I believe in, and which I say is exactly what Jesus Christ wanted. We can establish that kingdom. And I need your help in that. But now how? To get it voluntarily help from you, by chatting with you, talking to you. Over a period of time, you can be programmed, brainwashed, like all of us. We can be programmed, brainwashed into attitudes, behaviors. The communists got programmed. They established this thing. Under Hitler, the Nazi Germany, they were programmed. So everybody gets programmed all along the line. The Americans are programmed according to the democratic system. So everybody gets programmed. So we want to program you, and we in turn we allow you to program us. Let us talk. Let us exchange views.
Islam has experienced a revival in the world. And somebody said to me that it's reacting to it, the belief that Christianity is number one, perceived as a colonizer, number two, Western, and three, materialistic. And because there has been this revival, fundamentalist groups, and when I say that I'm talking the militancy that we experience, are taking advantage of this. Is this the case? Because the groups that are using violence seem to be tolerated and left to do those deeds, even though people like you will not agree with it, but they seem to be left alone.
They are being left alone everywhere. These guys in America, the Wackos and the Reverend Jim Jones and the Ferguson fellow, and the guy in Oklahoma bombing, what are you doing to them? They are there. You know they are there, walking in your midst. What are you doing to them? Nothing. The guy who's coming and knocking at your door, you know, every born-again Christian, is knocking at the Catholic's door. He's knocking at the Muslim's door. He's knocking at the Hindu's door. He's possessed with a spirit. He wants to change the world. What are we doing to them? We tolerate them. Don't we? We don't say, now the guy comes and knocks at my door, I kill him. No. Come, sit down. I would say, come, sit down. What have you got?
But the men knocking at the doors aren't using violent purposes, means to.
No. But now, that same militancy which that other guy is using, maybe he's put into a situation where you are not giving him the chance to talk. Like in South Africa. You see, it was supposed to be a democratic country for 300 years. Democracy of the white man. It's the white man who voted the white man into power. 80% of the people had no vote. And the political parties were banned. So what do I do? I blame Mandela now for spending 27 years in prison. No, I said the only thing he knew that he could do to change the system was what they were doing. So I sympathize with them. Though I'm not for violence. I said, what can I do? What do I do with them? I start fighting them. They say, no, they want to free me from the shackles of apartheid. Now what do I do? I don't know. What do you expect me to do? Do I start sniffing them out and going telling the government, I say, look, the guys are there on the Maputo border. What do I do? So in other words, you see that enthusiasm is there, and maybe it's a reaction, and this is the nature of things. God Almighty works in a mysterious way. You see, if the Christians didn't come and knock at our door, we might not have awoken up to what we are doing now. Do you know that? It's the Christian who woke us up. As a young man when I left school, I worked at Adams Mission Station, outside Amasintoji. Adams Mission Station, Adams College, built by an American for Africans. Across the valley from this institution was the shop where I was working. And the missionaries, what the training that they were getting, were experimenting all what they learned on the people working in the shop, all young men just left school, cheap labor. So they come along into the shop to buy bread, rice, sugar, flour, and at the same time they say, you know, Muhammad had so many wives. So I know nothing about that. I knew nothing about that. He says, you know, Muhammad, he copied his book, the Quran, from the Jews and the Christians. I know nothing about that. He says, you know, Muhammad spread his religion at the point of the sword. you force people to accept Islam. So if you don't accept Islam, you chop off your head. I know nothing about that. And none of the guys working with me knew anything about what these guys are talking. These missionaries. They're making life miserable for us. Attacking us. We are minding our own business. We want to sell sugar and soap, flour and rice. They want to talk about religion. Whatever training they get, they're experimenting on us. So they prodded me. I'm a type of person. By nature, God made me so. That now I want to find an answer. And I found an answer in a worm-eaten book. And that changed my life. That worm-eaten book. And now I write books as a result of what I had read in that worm-eaten book. Quarter million. I've reached quarter million of this. Quarter million of this. For my community, it's a stupendous figure. Yeah, continuation, volume 2. Volume 3, I'm writing at home now. I have written, millions of pamphlets have been distributed. That one I showed you about His Holiness the Pope, I did quarter million of that, this pamphlet. Quarter million. In Arabic and in English. So, in other words, it's working. It's working. But it is all as a result, is a reaction to what was being done to me. And today, on each and every Muslim home, a Christian missionary goes and knocks it. I've been asking people questions in public meetings. I said, is there a Muslim here whose door has not been knocked by a Christian yet? Please put up your hand. And the first meeting I asked this question, not one. I said, maybe they don't understand my English. So I repeat the question. I said, is there a Muslim here whose door has not been knocked by a Christian yet? Please put up your hand. Not one. Next one. Gathering. Not one. Next one. Not one. Out of five, one guy put up his hand. So I pass it as a joke. I said, you see, this man must be living in an ivory tower or somewhere in the basement somewhere, that somehow the Christian escaped him. It was a joke. Again, another series of meetings, another five, another guy also. One guy put up his hand that nobody has come and knocked at his door. Again, it's like a joke. If everybody, everywhere says, somebody has been knocking at your door and here, this guy, nobody. Again, the same type of remark. I said, you know, he must be living in an ivory tower, this man. But at question time, that man comes forward and he says, you see, when the Jehovah's Witnesses, then they visited me at home, then everybody laughed. I said, this is the guy who said nobody had knocked at his door. But he said, the Jehovah's Witnesses, when they came to him. So this is what it is. In other words now, the Christian is waking us up. You want our children. You want to convert them to us. This is the highest crime. This is apostasy. See, it is the highest crime. That means now, from the worship of the one true God, you're going to take away my child to go and worship Jesus Christ, a human being like myself, a great man, a mighty messenger of God. But he says, no, he's not a God himself. He's to be worshipped. He says, now, that's what my child will do. And as such, we believe he'll go to hell. And his children will go to hell. He is more dangerous. That missionary is more dangerous to me and my people than the Russians in Afghanistan, or the Jews in Palestine, or the Russians in Chechnya, or the Bosnians, there's the Serbs in Bosnia. The guy who steals my faith is more dangerous from the Islamic point of view than the guy who takes my life. Because if he takes my life, I go to heaven. The Afghanistan people, if they die at the hands of the Russian, we believe they'll go to heaven. If the Jews kill the Palestinian, I said the Muslim will go to heaven. You see, if the Serbs kill the Muslim, I said they'll go to heaven. If the Russians kill the Chechens, I said they will go to heaven. But you taking my child, my child will go to hell. So you are more dangerous. Stealing my faith is more dangerous to me than stealing my life.
Is it dangerous enough to use force against?
No. We talk. Let us talk. And we believe in talking. We have been talking. For the past 40 years I've been talking. City Hall of Durban, Johannesburg, Cape Town. I'm talking. And believe me, in 40 years, not a single person has thrown a rotten tomato at me or a rotten egg. Do you know that? And the most sensitive topics, most controversial topics, was Christ crucified. 1,200 million Christians say yes, 1,000 million Muslims say no. Realize the truth, you be the judge, and no incidents. No incidents. One meeting, same topic, between Dumini Papers of the Dutch Reformed Church and myself, at the Green Point, like 30,000 people gathered to listen to both sides. And no incident. Look, in other words, we are mature enough to listen to each other's points of views and make up our minds. This is what we want, which Islam expects. Then if you gag me, then I have a right to fight. Then I have to find ways and means to topple the government, even physically, even with guns and grenades. But if you give me religious freedom, give me a chance to talk, that's all. Give me opportunity to talk. Don't gag me. Because when you gag me, I might explode. So don't gag me. Then we give you the same opportunity. We don't want to gag you. Talk to us. Reason with us and we will reason with you. And by that process, we reach a conclusion that Islam is the way, which we believe it is, then let's be one in this fellowship of faith.
There's a lot of comparison in your writings and in writings and in speeches that have been broadcast to militancy. And the one says, by the Ayatollah Khomeini, I picked up this quote, jihad must triumph. Holy war means the conquest of all non-Muslim territories. The final aim is to put Quranic law in power from one end of the world to another.
The last statement, that the Quranic law must prevail, I stand for that. Because the Quran says, he says, he's given you a way of life, this religion, Islam. He says, لِيُزَهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينَ كُلِّ. A way of life, a deen, that is to master, overcome and supersede them all, kulli. Whether it be Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianism, Communism, Judaism, every ism, Islam is destined to master them all. H.G. Wells, the American historian, in his book The Shape of Things to Come, he says that Africa is a fair field for all religions, but the religion which the African will accept is a religion which best suits his needs, and that religion, everyone who has the right to speak on the subject, says is Islam. George Bernard Shaw, the great British playwright, George Bernard Shaw, he said, if any religion has a chance of conquering England, nay Europe, within the next 100 years, he said, that religion is Islam. But the sad thing is that the Muslims, we haven't made a start yet. Now I want to wake up my people, I said, make a start, man. This is the destiny, the Quran says this is your destiny. Truth against batil, against falsehood, any type of falsehood. This is must prevail. And as such we say, we have the truth, the whole truth, not partial truth, and we want to share with mankind. And we believe we'll succeed. Look, Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world today. And no guns. No guns and no grenades. In the West, what guns and grenades? In England, there are more Muslims than Methodists in England. Yeah, I don't know whether you know. There are more Muslims than Methodists in England. In America, we have something like nearing 6 million. What guns? What grenades? What force? No, it's the force of the intellect. Talk, man, talk. Reason with people. And there are people, good people, among all communities at all times, who will hearken to you. They say, no, this is the better way of life.
Hasn't the growth of Islam in the Western world and the Western cultures been because of the Western influence on Islam? Hasn't the Western way of life or influence...
No, then they'll become Christianized. But no, we are getting more converts into Islam than going out of it. I mean, an occasional here and there, for a young man, for a woman's sake, for money's sake, or for prestige, he can be converted. But theologically, I can't imagine a Muslim from leaving the worship of the one true God, the one that Jesus Christ spoke about. He said, God is spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in truth and in spirit, not in form, shape, or size. And we accept that, and we believe, and we live by that. To leave that and worship a human being, he says, no, this is now the highest form of blasphemy, that you say that this human being is God Almighty. He says, no. So in other words, now by reasoning with people, he said, look, Jesus Christ was a mighty messenger of God. We Muslims, we believe. That's what the Quran says. He's one of the mightiest messengers of God. We accept his miraculous birth, which many modern-day Christians, including the bishops of the Anglican Church, they don't believe today. Did you know that? And His Holiness the Pope, you know, he's also coming nearer to Islam. Here, this book here is unimaginable. This book, like the photo I was showing you, I said the photo was taken for me, the type of logic I used. I said, this book is also written for me. What do you say? He said, no. How can this world's bestseller be written for me? I said, look, I'll show you. I'll prove it to you. I said, you see, we Muslims are allergic to you saying Jesus is the only begotten Son, begotten, not made. We are allergic to that. The Quran takes strong exception to that statement of yours. Begotten, not made. So is the word begotten is irritating us. You see, when you say begotten, not made. See, God has, all, we are all His children, the good and the bad, the sinner and the saint. We are all His children. But Jesus is not like that, the Christian says. He is begotten, not made. Now, to us, we know the English that your forefathers taught me. Begetting means to have sex and produce. Genesis and Matthew chapter 1. It says, and this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And Abraham beget Isaac. Beget means had sex and produced. And Isaac beget Jacob, had sex and produced. And Jacob beget Judas and his brother, had sex and produced. Beget means to have sex and produce. So you say, Jesus is the only begotten Son, begotten, not made. If words have any meaning, we say, it means what it says, had sex and produced. You say, it doesn't mean that. I said, but that's what you're saying. So the Quran takes strong exception to that. Now His Holiness the Pope, he's written this book. 240 pages. He has used the Bible 209 times. There are 209 quotations. I counted them. Out of that, there is one John 3:16, which every Christian knows. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Every Christian missionary, he can't do without that. John 3:16. His Holiness the Pope has used John 3:16 seven times in this book. Let's start. Page 20. Page 54, page 55, page 56, John 3:16, and every time, seven times out of seven, the word begotten is eliminated. His Holiness the Pope, the Vicar of Christ on earth, he has eliminated the word begotten from his vocabulary. For who? I'm telling you, I'm sitting here, I'm getting things done. I make people to do things. It's the Almighty. He sets up everybody to help me in my work. If it is His work, He's helping me. He's helping me. I can see how doors are being opened up for me. Right? So, I'm telling the Catholics now. I says, come on. This is in your Roman Catholic Bible. The word begotten is there. In the King James Version is there. But His Holiness, seven times out of seven, has He forgotten it? What? Why did He take the word out? You tell me. I said, the reason is, I'm telling you. Because He is the Vicar of Christ on earth. He is the mouthpiece of Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity. He informed Him. I'm just assuming, talking, you know, thinking loudly. I said, you see, he said, my Father doesn't like that. Pope, watch Taylor, his name. Take it out. So he took it out. The world's bestseller. In 12 countries, within publication, within days, it became the world's bestseller in 12 countries. And the word begotten is eliminated from the English version and from the Italian version. And in every version, the word begotten is eliminated. For who? You want it? You Catholics? He says, no. You Protestants? You want that? He says, no. Who wants it? I say, I want it. I want that word to be taken out. And he took it out. For who? For who? For me. For Islam. So I said, you are coming nearer. It'll come one day, inshallah, that when he gets a direct revelation from God of himself, say, come on, accept Islam. You Baba, Pope, and make all your people to accept Islam. And it can happen. Miracles, I still believe miracles can happen.
That could be termed as blasphemous to Christians. Where do you see the future in South Africa specifically between Islam and Christianity?
No, I think you see...
Do you see Islam prevailing in South Africa and Christianity dying? Or do you see...
No, I see that. You see, because the African, by nature, is a monotheist. The African, in his mentality, you're talking about the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, he's bleating whatever the white man told him. But now when I'm talking to the African, I'm taking him back to the religion of his forefathers. I says, you Zulus, what do you call God Almighty in your language? He says, Umveli Ngami. I said, I'm asking an old Zulu, what is his Umveli Ngami? He says, who tells me, Umnimzan. Sir, Umnimzan, where are you? that he is a pure and holy spirit. Agazalia na fudi agazalwanga. He does not beget and is not begotten. Futi agukuluto lufananae. And there is nothing like unto him. That's all right. That is the real God. That is God. That is the God of the Quran. Have you been reading the Quran? He said, what is that? Never heard of the word Quran. But he's telling me what my Quran says. This is right. You are a Muslim. But now the white bus came along and took you off to make you to worship Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. A child born in the stable to a Jewish girl 2,000 years ago, circumcised on the eighth day. He is your God now. He said, yeah, Nimzan. That's what the white Mungu says that. This is your God. I said, Ulochiwe Pipele is written in your Bible. What he says, Ipelile is in Sugu, is the Shia Kalombele, Zoguba Sogwe. So when he was 8 days old, he was circumcised. But Kamalaku Jesu, and they named him Jesus when he was in his mother's womb. So I said, who was in his mother's womb? I said, Jesu. Who is Jesu? Jesus. Who is Jesus? He's God and the begotten Son of God. So he said, he was in his mother's womb. He said, uh-huh. I said, that how did he come out from there? He says, like you and me. He said, Khazela, Khazela, explain to me. How out of a woman's womb can the Almighty God of this universe come out? If you were a nurse 2,000 years ago, and you were helping Mary when she was delivering the child, can you for one moment think that that's your God, that's your Jehovah? That helpless little creature, coming out of his mother's womb with all the filth and the muck, the lubrication, which made his mother impure for 40 days, the Bible says. Is your God that? Your Jehovah that? Umvilingangi wakolok. Umkulunkulu wakolok. He says, he's a fool. He's a fool. Mungu washolok. The white man told us that. So who gave you this brain? The white man. Who gave you this brain? The white man. He says, no. Umkulunkulu. God. He says, what? According to your God-given brains, man. Is a child in the stable to a Jewish girl. Circumcised on the eighth day. Your God. No. It's a natural religion of African, as Edgewell says. That the religion which the African will accept is a religion which best suits his needs. And that religion, everyone who has the right to speak on the subject says is Islam. Unfortunately, we haven't really made a start yet. The Muslims haven't made a start yet. We haven't really made a start yet. But I want to wake up the people. So they get started. Yes, my sir.
Thank you very much.
I don't know how your views will take off that.
Yeah, I can't take all of this.
Hour and a bit.
Sure.
That's the end of the sign. All right, great.
No, you see, to us, the destiny of Islam, as the Christian we believe, the destiny of mankind is Christianity. That everybody starts in that every knee will bow before him. Submit to whatever Jesus said, that he is your God and he is your Savior. Mm. That is what the Christian ideal is. You and the whole world to be Christian.
But he is the one, the three in one is one God.
No. So now this is what, you know what, yesterday that missionary fellow, I'm telling him, I said, you know, the only problem between us, real problem, is this divinity of Christ. I said, you show me in your Bible, anywhere, in any Bible, where Jesus says, I am God, or where he says, worship me. I say, you understand my English?
Mm.
I say, where Jesus says, I am God, or where he says, worship me. Any version of the Bible, you show me and I will accept, I'll be baptized tomorrow. That was yesterday I'm talking. Tomorrow morning you can take me wherever you like and baptize me. There are three guys, all missionaries. Show me in your Bible, man, where Jesus says, I'm God, or where he says, worship me. That's as simple as that. So he says, you see, he opened up John chapter 1, verse 1. He said, read. I said, no, I don't have to read. I can tell you what it says. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. So I said, what is all this? Who's talking? Who's talking? And that happened to be this Bible here. And I says, you see, this is what they call the red letter Bible. You know what red letters for in the Bible? Which means every word that Jesus spoke, supposed to have spoken,
is
in red.
Yes.
I said, you know, that is black. Look, who put that black and red? Who? We did it? The Muslim did that? No. You Christian, 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, you got this Bible together. including the Roman Catholics. And the Lutherans and the whole lot of you got together and said, now, this is what Jesus is supposed to have said, read, and this is what, and it's not his words, somebody else. So it's in black. I'm telling you where he says, even that what he was quoting, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was this God, and the Word was, what does it mean? I said, where he says, I am God, or where he says, worship me. Because my salvation depends upon that, and yours also. Your salvation depends on believing that Jesus is God. My salvation depends upon denying that. Not trying to be funny. To deny that. But now, for that, I'm not trying to be unreasonable. I said, you show me in your book where Jesus says, I'm God, or worship me. I'm prepared to accept him as God. I'm prepared to worship him. Because I know the man will never lie. I can't believe that he would lie. If he said he's God, he's God. If he says, worship me, I say he's entitled to worship. Show me. There isn't. On the contrary. He says, my Father is greater than I. He said, my Father is greater than all. He said, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is righteous, because I seek not my own will, but the will of him that sent me. That's his greatness. That's his greatness. Whatever God wants him to do, he's prepared to do. At his last, the most critical moment of his life, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. He tells his disciples, wait and watch. And he goes a little further, and he falls on his face, and he prays to God. He said, oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass away from me. But not as I will, but as thou wilt. I want you to save me. But if you must, you want to take my life, for whatever your reason, I'm prepared to give it to you. That is submission to God's will. That one word for that in Islam is Muslim. Muslim is one who submitted. Jesus was a Muslim. He submitted his will to the will of God. I want you to save me, my Lord. But if you think it's better that my life be given, I'm prepared to give it. Not as I will, but as thou wilt. So we say he was a Muslim. Jesus was a Muslim. He was a Muslim. He submitted his will to the will of God, not following Muhammad. Because Muhammad wasn't born. 600 years later, Muhammad came. But this is, we say, Islam. Jesus was a Muslim. He taught us to worship God. He said, come, I'll teach you how to pray. Pray like this. And he gave you the words, like a little baby, putting the words in your mouth. He said, oh, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is God, our Father in heaven. He is talking to the disciples. And among them was Judas, the traitor was there. Peter, the guy who cursed, abused and swore him 3 times, was there. All the devils and the saints were there. And he's telling our Father, which art in heaven, yours and mine, including Judas, he is the father of everybody. Worship him, the Father in heaven. But you're worshiping Jesus. Is that what he said? If he told you to worship him, did he tell you to worship him? He said, worship him, the Father in heaven, and worship like this, and he put the words in your mouth, and still you won't articulate them. Is there something wrong? So I want to talk. I'm telling here, some Catholics came. I said, I give you 10,000 rand to get Bishop Hurley to have a dialogue with me in King's Park. I will organize that meeting. I'll get 40,000 people at King's Park here in Durban.
Will Bishop Hurley be allowed to speak?
Why not? I want him to speak for an hour, and I speak for an hour on the same topic, whatever it is. We choose a topic. See? You can't get them. I'm writing in the newspapers again and again. I said, His Holiness the Pope said, you must have a dialogue with the Muslims. I'm quoting him from his book. Wherever he goes to Turkey, he said, we must have a dialogue with the Muslims. When he went to Kenya, he said, we must have a dialogue with the Muslims. When he went to Nigeria, he said, we must have a dialogue with the Muslims. Do you know that? Wherever he goes, he said, we must have a dialogue with the Muslims. I said, right? Let's have a dialogue. Come, let's talk. You don't get a single Christian. I invited Bishop Hurley. And this Bishop Napier now. Yes, the Roman Catholic bishop. Come on, let's have a dialogue. And you get 40,000 people. At my expense, I can get 40,000 people to come and listen to you. And maybe SABC TV will also cover it. So 2 million, 5 million people will watch it. At my expense. And the Christians are terrified. I'm telling you. They're terrified. What? Do I swear you? Do I abuse you? I know my voice at times. It's louder than most people that you interview. But that's my nature.
Yes.
I'm not trying to to make it sound like that, you know, you have it. That's my nature. I want to talk.
Mr. Didat, could I ask you a favor? If we could take one or two shots longer than what you had, just of him working?
Oh, yes.